I just, you know, sometimes I go through my day and I get a little worried about our future. And I start to think, man, what's going to go on when these kids grow up? But after seeing what I saw this morning, I have hope. Ready?
Should be.
Are we on now?
Yep.
Can you hear me now? Okay, good. Excellent. So yeah, I was so blessed by those kids. And I was just thinking, I wonder, singing those little songs that Pastor Bob was talking about, I wonder if that's why so many of us older generation deal with so much fear, because we were so worried when we hit the bed, like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? And but anyway, I'm excited this morning, and Christy, I don't know where you are, if you're still in here, but there you are. Man, you had a word this morning. Woo! Wow, I was just going to say, let her preach, man, because she was on a roll. Between her and Pastor Bob, I think about most of my sermon has been preached this morning, but we'll take a look anyway and see what God wants to do. So if you'll open with me to Acts chapter 1, we'll begin in verse 4 this morning. Acts chapter 1, hopefully you have your Bible with you this morning. Want to go to some good places today. Want to see transformation in our lives. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful this morning for what you've already begun to do. And as I look around this room this morning, I see the result of your work in so many people's lives, Father. Those of us, Lord, who were on paths to destruction, Father, you've plucked us off of those paths and you've put us in good places, God. You've given us a purpose. You've given us direction. And God, you're going to bring those things to pass, Father, as we put our trust in you. And so, God, as we come this morning, as we listen to your word this morning, I pray that our hearts would be open. Father, I pray against fear. I pray against rejection. I pray against anything that would stand in the way of what you want to say to us this morning, Father. That there would be a freedom in this place, a freedom in our hearts to receive what the Spirit has for us, Lord. So we give this time over to you, God, and we just ask for you to just be glorified in what goes on in this place this morning. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I will do my best to get done in time. But I just want to remind you that, you know, the Bible says that with God, a day is like what? Anybody remember? Like 1,000 years. So this is like a blink of an eye to God. But I will do my best. It reminds me of a young boy who asked the Lord one time. He said, Lord, how long is a second to you? And God said, son, a second is like 1,000,000 years. And the young man said, Lord, how much is a penny to you? And the Lord looked and said, son, a penny is like $1,000,000. And the young man thought, ah, got it. He goes, Lord, can I have a penny? And the Lord said, sure, son, just a second. So anyway, I will do my best. If you hear me say I'll be done in just a second, believe me, I'm not talking God's time. Young man asked once, what does it mean when the preacher takes his watch off, and the guy sitting next to him said, absolutely nothing. So we will do our very best. Anyway, Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 4. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which, he said, you have heard from me. For truly John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. If you're taking notes with me this morning, I've entitled this message, And You Shall Be. And you shall be. Let me set the setting here, because we've read this scripture many times. Many of us are familiar with it. It's been preached many times. We've read it many times. But let me set what was going on. Jesus is speaking. This is the last words he's speaking to his apostles, his disciples. And you got to remember that they had just spent 3 years of their life walking with this man, Jesus. And they had seen the miraculous happen. They'd seen people get healed. They've seen provision. They've seen loaves of bread and small little fish just multiplied to feed thousands. They saw people raised from the dead. And they walked around thinking, man, we found our Messiah. We found God, and here we are walking with him. What a powerful time those 3 years must have been. And then it came to that last week, and they entered into Jerusalem, and here comes their Messiah riding in on a donkey, and they're thinking, things just can't get any better than this. And, you know, the people are laying down palm branches and singing Hosanna, and, you know, you just think everything is going great. Everything is set up for what we believe is going to be the restoration of the kingdom of God here in Israel. But things didn't quite go the way they expected them to go that week, because by the end of the week, within a few days, those same people who were saying Hosanna and laying down palm branches were now crying out, crucify him. And so within a matter of days, he went from the great Messiah coming in to save everybody to now being arrested, being tried, convicted, crucified, and buried. Man, like that, it just went from this wonderful thing to just a real bummer. Like, where do we go from here? And then came the news 3 days later that, you know what, he's risen from the dead. And now a whole new thing starts to stir in their head. Like, Mike, what is going on? I mean, we were just 3 days ago all bummed out about his death, and now they're talking about him raising from the dead. And, you know, some of them remembered him talking about the fact he was going to do that. And then he started to show up. You know, he appeared to the women first, and then he appeared to the two men walking on the road to Emmaus. He appeared to the disciples. And then the Bible says he appeared to more than 500 people in a 40-day span. So you got to think, these guys, the last 3 years of their life has been just a whirlwind. Many of them left family. They left businesses. They left loved ones. And man, their life was never the same. But here they sit with him, probably unsure about what's going to happen from here. I mean, we thought he was going to come and take over the throne of David and restore Israel to the place that it once was and that it was prophesied that it'll be again. But he died, and now he's raised again. We're not really sure what's happening. And this is where we find the scripture here. Jesus telling them, look, stay here. Stay in Jerusalem until the promise of the Father is given. But their response is interesting to me. Because their response was, Lord, is now the time that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? You see, Israel had been in captivity since the time of the Babylonians, when the Babylonians came and took over. The Babylonians took them off, carried many away to Babylon. The Medes and the Persians beat up the Babylonians, and they took over, and then the Israelis were subject to the Medes and the Persians, and then along came Alexander the Great. He beat up the Medes and the Persians, and now they're under control of Greece. Alexander the Great died. They broke it up into four different categories, and now they're under the control of a man named Antiochus Epiphanes, who was the one that went in and slaughtered a pig on the altar, which was an abomination. And it was a symbol that Jesus said of when the Antichrist comes at some point in the future and does the same thing. But it was that slaughtering of the pig that gave them a moment of freedom, because we had a group of people rise up, and it was known as the Maccabean Revolt. And they had a short period of time where they were independent, but then the Romans came on the scene, and then they were under the control of the Romans. So the apostles are just asking what every single Jew in that land thought at that time. Our Messiah is going to restore us to that prominence that we once had. This is going to be a land that is going to be great. It's going to be a godly land where God is in control, and he's going to rule with an iron rod. He's going to set the laws, and the people will have to obey. But you know what? Their focus was wrong. The focus was wrong, because when they asked Jesus, is now the time you're going to set it up? He didn't really respond to the question. He told them, well, that's in the Father's hand, but this is what I'm going to do. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pour out upon you the Holy Spirit, the promise from the Father, because I'm not about changing political, worldly kingdoms. What I'm about is I'm going to build my church. And I'm going to build my church through people who I have touched with the Holy Spirit and through the power of them and the testimony of them. And as they share with other people, I'm going to build a church. And it doesn't matter what political force comes against us. It doesn't matter what politician is in office or what nation rules what nation. It's not going to hinder what I do. He came to build a church of the good news. These people, through the power of the Spirit, were going to go out and not reveal the sin in the world, but they were going to go out and reveal the deliverance from that sin, because they were the church of the good news. I find the same today. Jesus is still building a church. That's still his plan, and he's still building it through a people who have been empowered by his Spirit, who through the sharing of their testimony are drawing people to the church. And the same is true today, that no political force, no nation is going to deter what God wants to do. You see, they can put people in prison in Iran for their faith. They can put the pastors in prison, but Jesus said, it's not going to matter. I'm building a church. That's what I'm doing. They can cut the heads off of Christians. ISIS can do that in the Middle East. But Jesus said, it's not going to stop the fact that I'm building a church. You know, they can take our liberties away here in this country, and they can tell us what we can say and what we can't say. But Jesus says, it doesn't matter because I'm building a church. And no political force is going to be able to deter it. Even though we can't, or even though political forces can't deter it, I think us as the church, though, can limit our effectiveness as God is building a church. Because he wants to use us to build it. And if we resist him in ways, then we can limit our effectiveness. And that's kind of what I want to talk about a little bit this morning. Let me take a minute just to discuss the status of what I see as the church in America today. I was reading on CNN the other day, and they were talking about another one of these studies that were done, and it seems that the church is in decline. The more people today have a negative view of the church than they did, say, 10 years ago. And, you know, these things can kind of shake you a little bit, and you start to wonder, well, what's going on, especially when they do the study with young people, and they find that we're having less of an effect on young people than maybe the older generation. You start to wonder, you know, what's going on? And then you hear the atheist saying, you know what, the church is done. You know, the church is going to, it's just going to die off, or at the very least, it's just going to become irrelevant in our society. But you know what? I'm not really concerned about the church dying off or becoming irrelevant. That doesn't concern me because, like I said, Jesus is building a church. He said, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell are not going to prevail against it. So it doesn't matter what man do. He's not going to stop the building of the church. Down through the ages, there's been a lot of atheists who felt like they were going to be able to see the end of the church. A man by the name of Voltaire believed that, he goes, within 100 years from my death, the Bible will become an irrelevant book. And you know what? He said this back in the 1700s, and today the Bible is the greatest selling book today of all time and still is. So what he thought was going to happen didn't happen because Jesus is building a church. There was a man named Friedrich Nietzsche, who I guess has been credited with coining the term that God is dead. It was very big back, I guess, in the 50s and 60s, God is dead. And there was a man who I heard speaking, walked into a bathroom one time, and written on the wall was the term God is dead. And right underneath it, you know how you give credit to the person that said it? It said God is dead, and then Nietzsche. And it was so funny because he said right underneath that, someone had come at a later time and written Nietzsche is dead, God. So, man can proclaim all that they want that the church is going to fail. But you see, Jesus is in control. And Jesus is the one that decides whether the church will fail or whether it will succeed. But I'm still concerned with how effective we are. And you know, when I look at these things, I want to be positive, but I also want to look with an eye for the truth. What's really going on? And as I look around, I think, you know, our effectiveness is declining some in some areas. We're not seeing the impact in our society or in our community the way we may have seen it in the past. I look at the way the world views the church, and the world kind of has a negative feeling concerning the church. They look at us not as people who are bringing hope or bringing good news, but oftentimes they see us as people who are just bringing a condemning word and condemning them for what they're doing, a very judgmental group of people. Now, I know that's not really in our hearts. That's not our desire to do that. But if we want to impact, if we want to affect our society, we have to take a look at how do they view us? And is there anything that we're doing that may be causing that, even though we may not want to be doing that? So I've been looking at that, and I've been like, yeah, you know, we're losing our effectiveness in some of those areas. But why are we failing? Why are we having struggles in this area? And as I've been thinking about it, as I've been looking through the Word, as I've been listening to the Spirit of God, I think what I've settled on is it's our focus, what we're focusing on. And as you look down through the history of the church, there's been times the church in different countries has gone through times of great power and times of great decline in different areas. It's kind of like a roller coaster ride. It goes up and then it kind of goes down. And as you look at those times when the church has gone into decline, you can see most of the time that their focus begins to shift and they begin to start becoming very legalistic. They begin to care more about the behavior of the people than about changing hearts. And it's almost as if the church starts to feel like, you know, well, I'm the bodyguard of heaven. I haven't been a Christian all my life, and I used to go to nightclubs before I was a Christian. And, you know, there's always that big dude who's like about 6'8 and 340 pounds without an ounce of fat on him. And, you know, you couldn't get in unless he said you could get in. And, you know what, I wonder sometimes if the church begins to go into those places and we start to tell people, you're not fit to get into the kingdom of heaven. But you know what the truth is? None of us are fit to get into the kingdom of heaven. There's not one of us that are fit. It's only because of what Jesus has done that makes us qualified for the kingdom of heaven. And that's the same truth for me, it's the same truth for you, and it's the same truth for every single person in the world today, no matter who they are, what they've done, where they live right now. And you see, that's the kind of church we need to be. You know, I heard a man say once to me, he goes, you know what? You don't have to tell a sinner they're a sinner. You know what? You didn't have to tell me I was a sinner. I knew I was a sinner. I didn't need anybody to point it out. I knew. In fact, I stand here on this platform today knowing my heart, knowing a lot of things that you guys don't know. And if you did know, you wouldn't need to tell me because I already know. You know, the world is that way. You know, they don't need to be told they're a sinner. When we turn to legalism, when we turn to dealing with behaviors, what happens is we turn away from what the Spirit of God wants to do. We cease trusting in His power. Because now we're doing our own thing. We're doing something that goes along with our own understanding rather than what the Spirit's doing. Because when it began, Jesus said, I'm going to build a church, and it's going to be a church of the good news. You're going to go and share your testimony with people of what Jesus has done for you, and through that, people are going to come to me. But somewhere along the lines, I've gotten to the place to where I've quit sharing what Jesus has done for me, and now I'm seeing through these glasses that only see the sin in people's life. And I begin to tell them, this is why you can't make it. This is why you can't make it. This is why you can't make it. And pretty soon, I become that bouncer in heaven, right? So I start being exclusive. I start saying, if you want to come to heaven, you need to come through me first and let me know that you've taken care of all of these behavioral issues. And the spirit stops. The power stops, because that's not what God's doing. That's not his message to mankind. So as I look at our effectiveness, I think that we've drifted a little bit in that direction. And obviously it's not everybody. I think this church does a great job. But I'm just generalizing as from what I see in America. And it's not just America, it's the Church of the West. So you go to Europe, Europe has reached a place now to where there's a whole generation that has no idea what Christianity is about. It's been so long since there's been a very powerful force there. If we're not careful, we'll become more concerned about changing behaviors than changing hearts. And we have to guard against that, because that's not what God is doing. That's not what the Holy Spirit is doing in this time. You see, our country is in bad shape. As Christy was saying, it's in bad shape, horrible shape. I mean, people are confused in our world. I mean, people are confused about sexuality, people that are confused about their gender, people are just confused about everything. They don't know what's up from down anymore, it seems. I mean, when ESPN decides that the most courageous person in the world was a person who's confused about his gender identity, and we're going to honor him for that, we're confused. We're a confused society. And you know what? Our society needs a church. It needs a church of the good news. Someone who's not going to come and point out all the things that we're confused about, but someone is going to say there's hope here. I was talking with Dee a few weeks ago, and I had seen an article about Target. And maybe some of you have seen this, that they're removing a lot of their gender distinctions with some of their merchandise in their stores. I'm not sure how it all will look. I know that they're doing it with the toys. They'll no longer say these are boys' toys and these are girls' toys. And there's other areas as well. And it just kind of goes with our society. We're just trying to blur the distinctions. And we just got to talking about that, and we got to talking about the fact that there's this whole generation of people, and when I'm saying generation, I'm not talking age-wise. There's this group of people who are buying into the fact that if I just live this lifestyle, I will experience peace, I will experience fulfillment, and I will experience happiness. And these are lifestyles that God says, no, you won't. I forbid these not because I don't want you to have peace and fulfillment, but I forbid them so that you will. But we've bought into it, and I don't mean we here, but as a society, we bought into the fact that if I'm just allowed to run after these things I'm feeling inside of me, I'm going to experience peace and fulfillment. Well, we all know the truth is they're not. And there's going to come a point where they recognize that. There's going to come a point where they wake up one morning and say, I still don't feel any peace, and I still don't feel any fulfillment in life. And it's going to be at that point to where they need a church. They need a place where they can go to, where they feel like they can walk in and be welcomed, where they can be touched by the Spirit of God, and they can find the true fulfillment and the true peace. And as me and Dee were talking, we got to thinking, you know what, there's going to be such need for healing and deliverance during that time. We have got to be a people that are ready for that. And I believe that's what God's saying to us now. We need to be prepared for what's coming up. We can't be so focused on the decline that we may see in the natural, but we got to be ready in the spirit so that when these people come back, they find love, they find acceptance, they find the healing that they need, the deliverance they need, and through that they find Jesus, they find fulfillment for their lives. See, these changes that we need in our society are not going to come through political change. I'm a firm believer, the Bible teaches that when the godly are in charge of a nation, the nation prospers and is blessed. And I believe we live in a nation where we have the right to be able to vote for who's going to be our leaders, and I think we need to take that right seriously and take the responsibility of voting for the proper people. I believe that many of us here need to get involved in politics because we need godly people to lead. But don't be fooled to think that if we just get the right political party in office, that all these problems are going to be solved. If we just change these two or these three laws, everything will be good. Because it's not going to be, because the problem is not a physical one. The problem is a spiritual one. And that's what God is calling us to. So we're not going to see a change just by changing the political climate or a change in the laws. And I believe that was what Jesus' point was when he spoke to his disciples. Real change was not going to come by restoring the right politician to the throne in Israel. That wasn't going to bring the change that they needed. The only change that the people needed was a church that was baptized in the Spirit of God, filled with his power, and sharing their testimony of what Jesus could do for you. See, they became a church of the good news. And everywhere they went, they shared with people, you know what, it doesn't matter what you've done. Jesus died for it on the cross, and all you need to do is come to him. Just come, repent, be baptized, believe. And in those moments, times of refreshing will come upon you. You see, those are the words that need to be coming forth from our mouths. Those are the things that God is calling us to. These are the things that the Holy Spirit is empowering us to say. So they were commanded to wait. And wait they did. Now let me point out three quick things that I see concerning this command to wait. One, the command to wait probably did not make a lot of sense to them. Because Jesus told them to wait till the promise of the Father comes. I don't read anywhere in the Bible where Jesus talks about what that's going to look like. So you're all going to be up in a room. You'll all be praying. There'll be this mighty rushing wind come in. Then there's going to be these things kind of look like tongues of fire. They're going to settle upon you. You're going to open your mouth and you're going to speak. But the things that you speak are not going to make any sense to you. I mean, he doesn't tell them what it's going to look like. He just tells them, wait. I hate waiting. I don't know about you, but it's about the worst thing in the world to me. I mean, I can remember Pastor Floyd, and some of you guys used to go to the men's meetings when he would share, and he would share about how God was teaching him these things about waiting. He would share some of these stories about being in these lines and some of the things that were going on, and I can just remember laughing, but why was I laughing? Because I could relate, right? I knew, you know, you're in that line, and you got a lady up front, she's looking for the exact change, and you're like, I'll pay it. Let's go. You know, or the other day I was in there and the lady at the cash register obviously was talking to a friend of hers and she was just talking about how her daughter graduated high school and she's applied to this college and that. And I'm thinking, nobody cares. Let's go. You know, I got things to do. But I hate waiting. I mean, probably the most powerful time is a few years ago I went to Africa. And it seemed like it didn't matter what line I got in. I mean, I was in all types of lines. I was in security lines. I was in check-in lines. I was in custom lines. I was in lines everywhere. And it didn't matter what line I got in. It stopped. I was standing in one line. We stood there. All of us stood there and watched this line just go just right next to us. I said, well, enough of this. I'm going to move over to this line. I moved over to this line. It stopped. And this line over here, all of them that were with us, they just went zoom. I went, it was so bad. Is it right? It was so bad that they even knew it, right? They started to say, what line is Mike getting in? Because we're going to get in a different one. I mean, that's how bad it was. And my wife looked at me and she went, sorry, honey. But I hate to wait. You know, I don't fully understand what the purpose behind waiting was. But I feel like God spoke to me this morning. He goes, it's very simple, son. Because when you wait, what you're doing is you are surrendering your agenda to mine. Our agendas aren't going to accomplish anything. You know, we want everything now, but our agendas aren't going to accomplish it. So we wait because God wants to destroy that agenda. He wants it laid down so he can move forward with his own. A lot of us, when we want to get touched by God, we have that same feeling. We're like, okay, Lord, here I come. I want to get prayed for. I'll fall down. I'll do whatever. But I need to be out of here and be down at Soup Plantation before the crowd gets there. So let's make this thing quick. I'm ready as long as you do it my way. But often it doesn't work that way. So they were commanded to wait, and they probably didn't understand. It probably didn't make sense to them. The second thing was, Jesus didn't tell them how to wait. I love it, though. They didn't know how to wait, so what did they do? They prayed. See, that's different than me, because I've got to the point now where I'll wait, but I wait differently than they waited. And the other day, God was sharing some things with me, and I was pretty excited about them. And you know, there were things that he'd been sharing for a long time, and I'm thinking, all right, time is now. I started getting busy, you know, I was making plans, I was creating different things, I was preparing, I was all ready to go, and I went out one night, and I like to sit outside under the stars and pray, and I went out there and said, okay, God, I'm ready, I got this going, I got that going. What's the next step, Lord? Wait. Like, oh, man, wait again. But they didn't know what they were doing, so what did they do? They prayed. They prayed, and they waited. There are times when you need to be touched by God, and God just saying, come and wait upon me. Wait in prayer until that thing that I've promised you comes. Now, these people, they didn't know. They didn't know what to expect. They didn't know exactly when it was coming. All they knew was, we're just waiting. We're waiting and we're praying. And, well, what's it going to look like, Peter? I don't know. We're just waiting. When it comes, I feel like we'll know what it is then. But until then, we're just waiting. We need to be people that learn how to wait upon the things of the Lord and wait until what God has promised has come. The third thing I see here is many were there because they listened to their leaders. You know, when Jesus spoke, he was speaking to his disciples. There were 11 at the time. I'm not sure if they were all there, but he was speaking to his disciples. But yet we see in the upper room later in the chapter that there were 120 of them there. So somehow the word had gotten from Jesus to the disciples, and the disciples took the word to these 120. I can see them coming back. What did Jesus say? He said, wait. But you know what? They were obedient to it. You know, there's times when our pastors, there's times when our leaders tell us, come. Come receive what God has for us. You know, and they're hearing the same thing that the disciples were hearing. Come wait on the Lord because he has something for us. We don't know what it's going to look like. We can't tell you what it's going to be. All we know is Jesus said, come and wait and receive. Now, I have to admit, I've been guilty in the past of ignoring some of those commands. And you know, I had to find myself repenting from those things this week as I was putting this together. It's like, Lord, I'm sorry. You know, I've heard my pastors call me to the front and say, come receive what God has for you. And I've ignored it in those times. And I don't ignore it at their peril, but I ignore it at my peril. And I'm going to do my best not to ignore those things anymore. I love our pastors and our leaders here because they're not afraid to wait. Not afraid to wait on what God wants to do. So many times, the pastors want to be so in control that when God says wait, it's hard to do. Because when you wait, you're out of control. But we're in a good place here. They're not afraid to wait. They're not afraid for that awkward silence. You know, there's times in our home group where Josh and Mel are leading in worship, and it just, the presence of God is heavy and it's strong, and we get to the end of the song and they quit playing, and I'm about to say something. I hear the Spirit of God go, shh, quiet. And I sit there, and after what seems like about an hour and a half, it's really only about a minute, but it seems long when you're, I'm thinking, Lord, I need to say something here. And he's like, why do you need to say something? I'm like, because there's this awkward silence going on, and I'm sure people, I got my eyes closed, but I'm sure everybody's looking at me. And I need to say something. You know, sometimes we just need to wait for what God is going to do. And that's what they did. They waited. They waited in that place, and they waited for 10 days. 10 days they waited until the promise of God came. And that's where we are in Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. It says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They waited for the promise of God, and when it came, they were there. And they were changed. They were changed. Because the next thing we see Peter going out and preaching. I mean, here's Peter who only a few weeks earlier couldn't even stand in a group of people and say, I'm a follower of Jesus. He was denying him and running away. But now we see him preaching and 3,000 people are getting saved. And Still, every time I read it, blows me away. I'm like, what would we do if 3,000 people walked in here right now and got saved? Woo! Hey, what do we do? It's like, we need Dennis. We need some more chairs. But, I mean, it's a good problem to have. But, I mean, imagine 3,000 people. I mean, you go from 120 to 3,120 in your church in one day. But you see, that's how the Spirit moves. When you start operating according to how He wants to talk, and you start saying the things that He wants to say, and those words that you're saying have been empowered by the Spirit of God, then we see things like that happen. You see, and I believe that's what God wants to do today. You see, they got baptized in the Spirit, and they became the Church of the Good News, and they began to change the world in a way that a politician couldn't do it. And see, God wants to do the same thing today with us. He wants to pour out His Spirit upon us. He wants to baptize us. He wants to empower us so that we can speak with the same power, the same authority that they spoke with in those times. We need to be those people. We need to be the Church of the Good News again. That's what our society needs. The only way that we'll be effective and successful is the same way that they were effective and successful. And that is, they were empowered by the Holy Spirit to do what they were doing. And they were obedient to what He told them to do. That's the only way we're going to be effective. If we walk in our own strength or according to our own understanding, we're going to go to those places of legalism. That's just what's in us. We don't really have any choice in the matter. We're going to go and we might share Jesus, but pretty soon we're going to start turning to the why you can't make it. If you'll just change this about yourself, you might make it to heaven, like me. But that's not what Jesus is saying. You know, there's some of us here this morning who've never been baptized in the Spirit. I'm not saying you're not saved. These guys that were here in this upper room, these 120 were saved people. We see that in the Gospels. They were saved. But they still lacked something. Peter lacked something when they asked him if he was a follower of Christ, and he had to say, no, I don't even know that man. He was saved, but he lacked something. There's some of us here today that are lacking something. We're saved, but we're lacking something. There's also some of us here today who you've received the baptism of the Spirit. But there's been that kind of dryness going on in your life lately. You don't really understand it. Can I tell you that the Bible doesn't say the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a one-time thing? It talks about continuing to be filled with the Spirit. And as we're continually filled with the Spirit, we walk in the power. But when we say, I've been filled before, I don't need that anymore, we begin to get hard. We begin to get calloused. We begin to turn and operate in our own strength. So whether you've never been baptized in the Spirit or whether you need a fresh filling or refreshing, the scripture gives us some clues here on how we can be ready. First of all, they were obedient. They waited in Jerusalem. Jerusalem wasn't an easy place for them to wait. Many of them were not from Jerusalem, and it was the place that killed Jesus. So I got to imagine all these people that put Jesus to death probably didn't look too kindly on the followers of Jesus as well. Yet Jesus told them, you stay here. Sometimes the hardest thing to do is to stay in a difficult place when God has told you to stay and wait for the promise of the Father. Sometimes that's the most difficult thing. But yet they were obedient and they stayed. Second thing, they were available. They were in the right place at the right time when the Spirit fell. Doesn't say anything about anybody else in Israel getting filled with the Spirit on that day. The Spirit of God fell in that upper room that day, and they were there. I said earlier that Jesus had appeared to 500 people during that 40-day period. And I wondered when I was looking at, where were the other 380? I mean, they had seen Jesus with their own eyes, resurrected from the dead. You'd think that would have some type of impact on your life. Now, I don't know, maybe they had a good reason for not being there. I don't know. Maybe their lives were just so busy. Maybe there was fear. I don't know what it was, but they weren't in that room that day. But those that were in that room, they were in the right place at the right time because the Spirit fell and their lives were changed forever. The third thing is that there was humility in the place. It says that they were together with one accord. And one accord means unity. And unity means that every single person took their agenda, set it aside, so that the purposes of God could be fulfilled. Our own agenda is going to hinder the move of the Spirit in our lives. We have to learn how to submit what we want to do to what the Spirit of God wants to do. God is calling us to be. Not so much to do, but to be something. And through the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that's how we move from the realm of just doing things to being something. Jesus told them, you're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. And he's still saying that to us today. He's calling people to be something, not to do something. Is there somebody on keyboards? One of Christy's here or someone? Thank you. When I got saved, seems like forever ago, and I was saved right in the middle of the charismatic movement. And so I got saved. And some of you grew up in the church. I didn't grow up in the church, so I was a greenhorn when it came to the things of God. Somebody said, you need Jesus to be saved. I said, yes, and, you know, I got saved. But I didn't understand all the lingo of the church. I didn't know how the church operated. I didn't know any of that stuff. And, you know, we'd sit around, we'd be talking with my friends, and the issue of tongues would come up. And I didn't quite understand what they were talking about. And I remember one day, you know, one of them even said, oh, that church over there, they don't believe in tongues. And I remember thinking to myself, what do you mean they don't believe in tongues? We all have a tongue. What are they talking about? And I didn't get it. And then one day I heard somebody speak in tongues. And I hate to say, but I was freaked out. I listened to that. I went, whoo, like, that's tongues? I remember thinking, you know, I don't understand that, so I'm just going to avoid it. But the problem was I love the Bible, and I was just reading the Bible, and I was soaking it up, and I couldn't get enough of it when I was first saved. And the problem was tongues was in the Bible. You know, we read about it here. And I was like, oh man, it's what's there, you know, and I believe that every word in that scripture was from God. And so tongues were from God. And I had trouble with that. You know, the Lord really wasn't listening to me about it because I had something to say, but he wasn't listening. But I found some scriptures that seemed to help me at the time. You know, the ones that talked about, well, not all will speak in tongues. I was like, amen, that's me, brother. Or the one that said, those that speak in a tongue edify themselves. I said, well, see, that's just selfish. And I'm not selfish, so I'm not going to speak in tongues. It's just not going to happen. You know, but what I wasn't humble. I was prideful. And I was scared. I was fearful because I didn't know what it was going to look like. And I was like, I don't want to look weird, God. I don't know what that is. It doesn't make sense to me. What I needed were those children to come and to quote that scripture to me. Don't lean on your own understanding, but in all your nays, acknowledge him. Trust in him. Believe that what he says is a good thing. It came time for me to be baptized in water, and I was really looking forward to it. I knew that I wasn't complete. There was something that wasn't complete till I was baptized in water. And we had about 3 weeks before we could get, they were going to rent this little church, and which had a baptismal. And so I kept looking forward to the day. And the day finally came, and I mean, I woke up. I had never been so sick with the flu in my life. I mean, I was feverish, and I never get a fever. It just doesn't happen. But that morning, I was feverish. And I woke up, and I went, oh, my God, this has just got to be the enemy, you know. But somehow, I forced myself to get up. I forced myself to get dressed, get in the car. I drove from Pasadena to Pomona, 40 minutes. Somehow, I got there, because you know how you are when you're feverish, and you're kind of going in and out of kind of delusional, you know, reality is kind of warping a little bit. And so that's how I was when I get there, just a few people there. And I'm sitting there waiting for, you know, the whole baptismal to take place. And there were these two older ladies there. Oh, wonderful ladies. But when they found out I was sick, you know, they straight went to prayer. You know, and I'm telling you, man, the oil was flowing and arms were flinging and voices were shouting and they were casting this out and they were loosing this. And I mean, they were going for it. And me, I'm kind of going in and out and not really sure what's going on. And then all of a sudden they got to this place and they said, he's gonna speak in tongues today. And they started praying for me to speak in tongues. And oh my gosh, I'm like, this is not gonna happen. What are you doing? And I don't want you to get any bad thoughts towards these women, because one of the ladies that were doing it, I considered her a spiritual mother in my life. They cared for me. But the more they just determined that I was gonna speak in tongues, the harder I got. And I said, mm-mm, it's not happening. Well, they prayed and prayed and prayed, and I don't know how long it went on. It seemed like for days. But finally they decided, okay, well, he's not gonna speak in tongues. And we went through the baptism, and I had got this hardness in my heart. And I said, others can speak in tongues, that's fine, it's in the Bible, but I'm not gonna do it. And one night I was sitting and I was watching Christian TV, and I didn't watch Christian TV. It just wasn't of interest to me, but I had just been flipping through the channels, and I was in that vulnerable place where the Spirit of God was speaking to me. And I came across this preacher, and something about him just made me stop, and I was listening, and he was just sharing about the love of God and how much God loves you, and I just was in that place where I kind of needed to hear that. And then he began to talk about the gifts of the Spirit. And I began to receive those things and saying, yeah, that's great. But then he said something that changed my life. He started talking about how these gifts and how God just wants to give them to you. And he looked right into the TV, and it looked like he was looking right at me. And he said, don't you want all that God has for you? And my heart just melted. And I turned the TV off, and I went into my bedroom, and I got down on my knees, And I just started lifting up the name of the Lord. And I said, God, I want everything that you have for me. I realized, Lord, I've been prideful. And I began to repent for the pride that was in my life. And I began to cry and said, Lord, I'm just scared. None of this stuff makes any sense to me. And the Lord just began to minister his peace to me. And I just remember lifting my hands up and I started just praising the Lord. And the next thing I know, I was speaking in tongues. I didn't go in there to speak in tongues. That wasn't my purpose. I had no thought of speaking in tongues when I began to speak in tongues. I was just praising the Lord, and he did something in my life. And it changed me. It brought a peace to my life, a joy to my life that I hadn't experienced before, but it also brought a power to my life because I no longer was afraid to speak to people about Jesus, to speak to my friends who were, were all heathens about Jesus. Now, I'd like to say, like Peter, that I saw 3,000 people get saved, but I didn't. I didn't see 300. I didn't see 30. I don't even know if I saw 3 people get saved. But what I have seen is there was a gift deposited in me, a gift of teaching. And I have, over the years, seen people touched as Jesus has used that gift through me. And it all came through the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Without that, none of these things would have happened. My life. You see, there's gifts in each and every one of you. Good gifts, powerful gifts, things that everybody else needs that we may not have. But the catalyst to setting those gifts into motion, the power behind them, is when the Spirit of God comes upon you and erupts those things into life. And what I found out was that the gift of tongues were just, it wasn't just so that I could speak in the tongues of angels, but it was also that I could speak in the tongues of men with more power. That when I spoke words to people that they understood, it now carried a new authority and a new power. And it was that gift that I think God was really trying to work in my life. I speak in tongues today, and I speak in tongues a lot. I love it. But it's when I speak to people and I see the power of God working in their life is when I know, man, that was worth it. We need to go back to being the church of the good news. We need to be the type of people when we come into contact with others, we leave something good, that they're changed because of it. I'm going to ask you guys this morning the same question that that preacher asked me so many years ago. Do you want all that God has for you? Are you willing to lay down, put aside the fear, the pride, anything that keeps you back, so that you can have all that he has for you? You know, if the answer is yes, I'm just going to ask you to come forward. I'm going to ask if our pastors will come and lay hands upon you. I believe God wants to do a fresh outpouring, a new thing in your lives. He wants to set you free, set you loose to be the person he's called you to be. And can I share a word with you real quick that God gave me as I was putting this together? He told me that there are some here today who've been, you've been suffering from depression. And it's been worse lately than it has before. And I believe the Spirit of God is saying, or told me, that if you come forward, what he wants to give you today is going to bring a level of freedom from that thing. So again, if you want all that God has for you, if if you need a fresh touch from Him, maybe you need prayer, maybe you just need to come and bow at the altar, on the stairs, maybe you need to sit in the corner and get alone with God. I don't know what it's going to look like, but just come and God will touch you.